Good morning and welcome to the 26th meeting in 2023 of the Finance and Public Administration Committee. We have received apologies for today's meeting from Ross Greer and understand that Jamie Halcrow-Johnson is travelling and will be delayed. We have one public item on the agenda today, which is an evidence session on the Financial Memorandum to the Circular Economy Scotland Bill. And I welcome to the meeting Charlie Devine, Service Manager, Waste Partnership, Dundee City Council. Kirsty Maguire, Waste Manager, South Lanarkshire Council, and Jim Jack, Head of Operational Services, West Lothian Council. I welcome you all to the meeting, and I intend to allow up to 75 minutes for this session. We have your written submissions, so we will move straight to the questions. And I think, actually, Mr. Devine, I'll go to you first. And the reason I'm going to go to you first is because we sent out a number of set questions that we do for all financial memoranda, and unlike your colleagues, you've actually completed the first three, so we're going to put you on the spot first. But then, of course, if your colleagues wish to chip in, then they're more than happy for them to do so. So basically, when you were asked about to comment on the financial assumptions made, you talked about insufficient financial detail, and you said the Scottish Government should consider the impact of additional capital and revenue costs required to implement, manage and maintain the required changes at a time of considerable budgetary pressure for local authorities. So I'm just wondering if you can actually kind of enlighten us as to what these additional capital and revenue costs would be.
Aye, certainly. I suppose then in the first instance is obviously infrastructure. Infrastructure is obviously quite considerably expensive for waste management and treatment. So having to sort of put new infrastructure in place. And I recognise, obviously, the recycling or infrastructure fund is available for local authorities to bid into. So that was obviously one element of that, but that wouldn't be, in terms of the £70 million that's there, wouldn't be sufficient, I don't think, for all of Scotland, and certainly for if we were to do something considerably different from what we're doing at the moment, whether that investment would be, the money would be available to do that. And obviously, if we do make that investment, then obviously there's the cost of running those particular infrastructure facilities, for instance. So that was where we sort of that fairly general comment came from. So it was really about if we do go down a lot of the recommendations that are within the Circular Economy Bill, in which Dundee is actually quite far down the road in terms of the Household Waste Recycling Charter and fully adopting that, things like that, but some of the changes that are there will require additional facilities and additional money to manage those facilities. So it was really just to highlight that to the committee in the first instance and just to make them aware of that. That I suppose the point I always try to get, the full suite of infrastructure isn't there at the moment to do a lot of the changes, so it was just to sort of highlight that to you in that instance and obviously give you an opportunity to discuss that and see where it could go from there.
Back in 1981, Claire Grogan in the film Gregory's Girl said that boys think in numbers, and I'm one of those people. So I wonder if you can put some numbers on what we've said, given that the financial memorandum is all about the numbers, in fact.
Oh, God, I couldn't give you that level.
It's all about best estimates, isn't it, really?
I suppose you'd be talking about, for developing an additional household recycling facility, for instance, it could be £1.5 to £2 million, you know, for a very basic facility. For that, so that would obviously increase the ability for people to bring material, for us to sort material, but obviously you would then have to staff that, which could be anywhere from 5 to 10 staff, you know, so that could deal with that.
This would be essential to deliver this bill, in your view?
It would be a key component part of it, along with other things as well. It wouldn't solve the number of sort of additional items that we would need to try and sort of deal with on its own, but it would be part of a sort of a wider plan.
Okay, and I mean, you know, I'm just wondering if your colleagues, Jim and Kirsty, have got anything to say in terms of this particular issue, which is about, you know, additional resources that may be required to deliver this.
We haven't made any comments on that, but picking up from Charlie's point in terms of additional costs for infrastructure, actually, we have been kind of looking at putting in additional infrastructure because it's something that South Lanarkshire is pretty short on, given the size and the geography of the area. And I'd say that £1.5 to £2 million is probably quite conservative, especially when you're looking at purchase of land on top of that. So,
okay. Mr. Jack, I know you also didn't specifically comment on these early questions, but I'm sure you've got some thoughts on them.
Yeah, thanks, Chair. I mean, in terms of the Recycling Improvement Fund, West Lothian's benefited quite a bit from that, and we are progressing twin stream recycling at the moment, but that's been a major behaviour change exercise, and that's what's required for the Circular Economy Bill as well, and that takes a significant input in terms of education, coercion, coaxing along, whatever way you want to put it, with our communities. And that, and we have two pilots running at the moment which are taking four staff working in these areas just to do that education and engagement as we go in front of the collection service to reduce contamination, which is a significant cost to the council as well.
Yeah, I think the bill was talking about £2.95 a household or something like that for education, behavioural change, etc. Is that a figure you recognise? Or
costs that we're in at the moment, we're probably above that. I haven't looked at it in that level of detail. As I say, we have some resource there that we'll be able to put in, but that didn't come from the Recycling Improvement Fund. That's capital-based, so it paid for the infrastructure, the new bins and the stuff that was required there. The programme that we've got on the go at the moment has got a target for reducing contamination and a saving to the council, and I'm netting off the staff costs from that.
Okay, and back to you, Mr. Devine. Again, in the second question, you said that some of our responses to the initial consultation are irrelevant or require further review and updating, and you touch on forthcoming legislative changes such as deposit return scheme, in which, or at least they were considered to be forthcoming, and the extended producer regulation. So I'm just wondering if you see where the these changes have been made and what the implications of that for Dundee.
Definitely. I mean, if those two, well, suppose deposit and return, if you like to take that as the first example, so that would remove an, a set volume of material from the local authority handling it, so that would change how the service would operate, for instance. And obviously, with the delay that's there, and then probably one of the key elements for that, which obviously wasn't considered at the time with our response, would be the removal from glass from the system, which basically, in terms of volume or weight, constitute quite a significant part to that. So the local authority would continue to handle that material. So again, we would need to go back and relook at it in terms of how we would forecast that. In terms of the extended producer responsibility, so again, that's a UK-wide piece of legislation, and it will be dealt with in that particular aspect. So how the money that's going to be given up from the producers and how that's distributed to local authorities isn't clear, and how that would be there. And obviously, if packaging, for instance, changes, either reduced volumes of it or how the packaging is actually made changes as well, so that would have to be considered in terms of how recycling systems were set up and how sort of the back-end contracts of sorting and recycling that material would work. So there's quite a few kind of unknowns there, which made it really difficult. And again, probably if you asked me the same question again, given what we've got, we'd probably give you more detail and probably be better kind of place to give an accurate response.
Yes, I mean, you know, the extended producer responsibilities expect to bring in about £1.2 billion a year across the UK, so that's £100 million across £100 million perhaps for Scotland, so it might be £2 or £3 million for somewhere like Dundee, but it doesn't, you're right, I mean, it's very hard to kind of pin down at this stage. I mean, just moving on to yourself, Ms. McGuire, one of the issues, of course, that's come up and mentioned is the littering issue, whereby people who litter from cars will be potentially fined. And the financial memorandum talks about the cost of actually policing that. And then dealing with that are between £34 and £102 per notice. But all of you have expressed concerns about the kind of about how collectible that is. So what are your concerns and those of South Lanarkshire?
Well, there's a number of concerns. First is that, again, due to the size and the geography of South Lanarkshire, we don't believe that the numbers of enforcement officers are realistic if we really want to deliver on that. Secondly, it's the cost. So it's difficult for us to recruit officers. We're struggling to recruit enforcement officers, environmental health officers, and so we're having to pay officer rates. So we feel as if the estimates for how much it's going to cost us are on the low side. And we also think it's important to maybe perhaps be realistic about the incomes that we are predicted to get from fines. there's a prediction that we would get 100% of fines would come back into us, and that's not the case. So between 10 and 15% of fines are paid for offences at the moment. And if we don't get paid, then it's reported to Procurator Fiscal. And if the Procurator Fiscal does take the case, then it generally will result in a fiscal fine. None of that money which comes from a fiscal fine actually goes into local authority budgets. So that's a concern for us as well. And I think, looking at everyone else's responses, we're all kind of saying the same thing, that what we really want is an education programme. We want communications. We want investing in our waste education teams from a South Lanarkshire perspective. And I think probably across local authorities, when savings have had to be made, that waste education teams have been one of the teams who have been affected by cuts. And because of that, councils do not have the resources to do the education awareness raising that is required to make this successful.
Okay, Mr. Jack.
Yeah, I think, Chair, we've got very similar concerns. A part I would add is the demographic that are likely to be fined are some of the hardest customers we've got to engage with to bring forward this type of behavioural change. And then they face the dilemma, I suppose, between paying fines and paying rent, put bluntly.
I think one of the issues, in fact, indeed specifically talked about that, but Mr. Jack, I wonder if that's an issue for yourself or indeed for Ms. Maguire in terms of West Lothian and South Lanarkshire, about recycling and trying to increase it from flats, for example, rather than just, you know, your garden-gated properties. How do you think this bill will help in to be able to deliver that? Or do you think that there's an overestimation in terms of the amount of waste that will be collected in appropriate receptacles from this bill?
I think, Chair, speaking from West Lothian's experience, we're looking at flat properties just now as part of that recycling improvement fund bid that we were funded for. Some of the difficulties we're having is multi-ownership of the flats from individual tenants to housing associations and others and the council itself. And you would think it would be easier to engage in terms of our own tenants, but again, they tend to be, in some cases, a quick turnaround. So there is concerns there about just how effective that engagement is. The other side as well is making sure that the additional receptacles that we put in to segregate waste don't just simply become another grey bin. And the process that goes with that. And that's taken quite a bit of time to work through. Most of our flatty properties only offer at the moment either a grey bin general waste collection or a mixed co-mingled paper card and tins and cans, and we're hoping to change that. But it is quite as Kirsty said, it takes a lot of upfront time to make that change and then a lot of input time to keep the messaging consistent.
Okay, and Ms. Maguire, what about South Lanarkshire in terms of flatted properties?
Well, South Lanarkshire is our biggest concern is our flatted properties. So a number of years ago, we did a campaign, we introduced a new service standard, and we became less tolerant of contamination with our recycling bins. It was quite labour intensive. It took many months, negotiations just to get by our elected members in the first instance, and then actually to do the education and awareness raising with members of the public. But we did benefit from a pretty significant increase in the quality of the material that was collected in our recycling bins. But conversely, it ended up with a lower recycling rate, because actually what had happened was that everything that was in the recycling bins was being counted as recycled. Actually, after we cleaned up recyclable material, our tonnages went down. So it looked as if we were performing less well than they had been, when actually, if you looked behind the data, we were performing, our improvement had... there was an improvement in terms of the quality of the material. That could only work with properties where we had four bin system and they had bank and front doors. Unfortunately, we have over 30% of our properties are multi-occupancy, and we also have a very high proportion of terraced properties. So there is difficulty there in providing bin infrastructure. There's difficulty for people bringing out bins because they don't have access from their back garden to the front garden to where the collection point is. And a lot of the time, we've had to revert back to sack collections, which are not helpful when you're looking to improve the amount of recycling that you're collecting. And also, gives you issues with refuse accumulation, refuse in back areas, and so sometimes you have to revert to going back to a weekly residual waste collection, which doesn't help. But sorry, I kind of was got off the point a wee bit there. The point, I suppose, was that our flats are our biggest challenges, and even though there is potentially an option there to issue fixed penalty notices, the difficulty with flats is, who do you issue the fixed penalty notice to? And if they don't pay it, who do you refer to the procurator fiscal?
Yeah, I mean, I think that's something that you touched on, Mr. Devine, as well, actually, isn't it? You know, in terms of trying to chase people on that. I mean, one of the things, obviously, Ms. Maguire, that you've raised is the kind of the issue of how much actually the financial memorandum seems to believe that local authorities will have to pay in order to hire additional staff in order to actually monitor this. So you've talked about, for example, you know, the assumptions basically in terms of the full-time equivalent enforcement officer as being nowhere near the actual real cost. I wonder if you could touch on that, because your colleagues are obviously also concerned about that.
Yeah, I think the costings that we looked at was based on a grade 3 officer level, and an officer level within the council would be someone who would be responsible for enforcement, so general environmental enforcement. So with own costs, which we usually take to be about 30%, our estimates are that it would be around £55,000 per year per full-time equivalent for enforcement. We also don't have a post which is administration for enforcement. That again would have to be undertaken by an enforcement officer.
So these are basically hidden costs, if you like, which are not really considered by the financial memorandum.
Yes.
And Mr. Devine is kind of nodding there as well. Mr. Devine, this recycling improvement fund of £70 million, £53 million has been allocated to 17 local authorities. Do you feel that means that there's not enough left in order to cope with the kind of changes that have been that are now going to have to take place, with given the fact that the changes to DRS, etc., you know, what's happened there?
Probably I speak from probably a slightly more informed position, because I was part of the team that pulled the Recycling Infrastructure Fund together in a previous role for that. So obviously we knew some of the work in the background for that. So in terms of the real cost for that, probably considerably more, but that was what was available from within the Scottish Government capital funding part of that. So it was trying to make that fit anywhere the biggest priorities were. So again, it really just depends for each local authority where they are within their infrastructure requirements at the moment, whether they've been part of a previous investment cycle in terms of either some funds that have come from Zero Waste Scotland or Scottish Government Direct for that. So I think the biggest issue is it was probably more than double that would be the requirements for making sure everybody had the same type of infrastructure and could offer the same service. But the other challenge was, until all the local authority services are aligned, it's difficult for everybody to use similar type infrastructure. So again, the code of practice for household waste recycling was the key to that, and that's obviously that becoming more, if not mandatory or statutory, role within the circular economy bill would then align each service to produce similar type materials. So again, that kind of makes infrastructure more common. So again, some challenges there in the interim period.
And have each of your local authorities received funding? Is it interesting that 17 out of the 32 local authorities have received totaling £53 million? Now, obviously, the local authorities are different sizes, etc. But I'm just wondering if each of your local authorities has received that funding, or is this something you're in discussion with Scottish ministers about? You're shaking your head there, Kirsty.
In terms of Dundee City Council were one of the early adopters, so we received around about £90,000 for basically to try and sort of modernise the telekinetics and telecommunications within the vehicles to try and improve the service and service availability. And we're in the position at the moment of preparing a further bid for that for some capital works within our household waste recycling centre. So it's live at the moment for us. Whether the fund can actually, if there's enough sufficient money left by the time we've made the submission, it's assessed to do that, or the timeline suits the funding that's available.
Ms. Maguire?
South Lanarkshire haven't, and I think that's predominantly down to a timing issue. Our service review, which is, we're in the middle of a service review at the moment for waste services, and it was timed to coincide with introduction of the deposit return scheme. So Charlie had touched on the fact that there was, if glass had been included, or if glass is included, that it would have been an opportunity for us to make some efficiencies, because glass is about 60% of the material that we collect in our container bin, which is glass, plastics and cans. And so we could see some efficiencies there. So the whole timing of our review was based around the deposit return scheme. Obviously, the delay has had an impact on us. And then we have to also think about the introduction of the extended producer responsibility for packaging regs and what an efficient waste service would look like. So it's been pretty difficult. It's been pretty challenging for us to get a direction how our service is going to look. And I think until we know what our service is going to look like, then we don't know what we're applying for funding for. So I think if we had applied for large-scale funding, it would not have been good timing for us, because we would have potentially made different decisions based on how things are going strategy-wise at the moment.
That's interesting, given that the legislation is going through, Mr. Jack.
Yeah, Chair, we received a significant amount of money from the Recycling Improvement Fund. I think part of that was timing for where we were with service changes, principally driven by the requirement to make revenue savings across the council, but including within operational services. So we were able to fund the rollout from a co-mingled plastics, card, paper and tin and plastic bottles collection to splitting that, and a lot of the fund that we got went towards that. Equally, there was an allocation for flatted properties, which is a work that we're working through just now, and there was some money there for, as Mr. Devine said as well, for in-cab improvement technology to allow us a better understanding of presentation of bins and to deal with complaints as well. That was, as I've said earlier, was capital funding. I had to make significant savings within waste services revenue-wise, and that included moving to a seven-day collection service. So the timing of that review and the funding helped to progress that. I am concerned about where we are in the future and just what the journey continues to look like for waste services and our ability to be light enough on our feet, I suppose, and to be funded to achieve what we need. And I suppose that's our council's principal concern, is that we should be no worse off through this.
Yeah, I'm going to ask a final question on that in a minute, but I just want to ask about co-design. One of the things that this bill talks about, and it's not the first bill that this committee has dealt with, it's discussed the issue of co-design, is that they seem to talk about co-design going forward, which to me is always somewhat woolly, and it also means that much of the delivery of this bill will come through secondary legislation. So I'm just wondering if the panel can give me their individual views on that, starting with yourself, Mr. Jack, and then
I think that has been a concern for our council and my colleagues that have been looking at it, in terms of just, as I said earlier, understanding where we end up in terms of what the collection service will look like, but equally, I suppose, what the market looks like for the products that we have. We have a general waste contract going out now, due return in January, and the early indications is that the cost pressures on that could be very significant. So I think, as colleagues have said earlier, that none of us, certainly in our council, we agree with the principles. It's just how the market reacts and where the cost element and the risk, I suppose, sits, and how local authorities are funded through that.
Ms. McGuire.
I think co-design is where we want to be. We want to have an input. Local authorities want to have an input how the services will look like. I think the difficulty is there is so much variety and in terms of collection services, and that's because of local conditions. So what suits one local authority doesn't necessarily suit another. And, you know, we don't have infrastructure. We are really dependent on the processors who are on our doorstep, because we don't bulk, so we have to direct delivery. So that does influence what material types that you will collect. There's some local authorities who are reluctant to move away from a single stream recyclable collection, and believe that the way forward for every other local authority is to have the same, and that would work in a lot of properties where there is insufficient space, because there's older properties and refuse collection was almost like a last thought and the design of the architecture of properties, but it doesn't suit us because we get income from our waste streams. So, yeah, I think there's a lot more discussion that's required to find some sort of a compromise, and it does make me wonder whether or not there is one size that fits all, whether we can be as prescriptive as we have been in the past with the Code of Practice, where we've asked for separate glass collection, where we've asked for certain items to be collected at the same time, where frequency of residual waste collection has been not mandated, but you know, been recommended. There's a maximum frequency, and I think we really do have to consider, local circumstances.
Okay, and Mr. Devine.
Certainly, I mean, just to echo what my colleagues have said, is that it's the challenge of getting everybody to sort of, do things in harmony with each other. I think that there's a number of steps there. It's obviously been able to present consistent materials to the marketplace in some instances and be able to tie up local ways of working in terms of rural and rural, urban and urban as well. But there's also the other part to consider is that obviously within the EPR regulations is that those that place packaging in the marketplace want to get that packaging back in some way, you know, and that should be a pull on how the systems are designed to get the best quality material back into the market, but also from that point of view is to try and get a better price back for the local authorities for doing that. So what are the mechanisms within EPR will help that, and that would then become part of the design of the system, but co-designing it not just with each other, but again with the market to make sure the materials are there. And probably the way that we're set up is obviously we're trying to recover as much recycling as possible, but that might not be recycling that the market wants, so we don't get the best prices for it at the time, or we put a lot of effort into material and it won't have the best carbon impact, but it's the best for logistics and waste handling. So there's quite a few challenges in there, and the co-design thing I think would be quite a large part of taking this forward in terms of not just harmonising between local authorities, but harmonising the waste system and the system for materials use, and obviously the kind of closing that circular economy loop that everybody's trying to do at the moment.
And I mean, the Scottish Government seems determined to actually make this work, because they say that Scottish ministers will be enabled to impose statutory recycling targets upon local authorities with financial penalties if targets are not met. And in Wales, a local authority can be levied with a fine of £200 per tonne of waste by which it falls short of the target amount. So there's going to clearly be pressures on the local authorities. So just my last question, which is basically, you know, the financial memorandum talks in detail about savings, for example, from paper cups going to landfill and litter fines and this, that and the other. What is the kind of net? I know you've all said that any additional cost should be met fully by the Scottish Government. What is the net outcome in terms of this bill for your local authorities? Now, I realise, you know, you know, Mr. Devine, you were quite hesitant in actually talking about pounds, shillings and pence at the beginning of this question session, but where are we in the terms of the parameters for a city like Dundee to, in order to deliver this financial memorandum? Would it cost the city an extra half a million, and a million, 2 million? Because obviously we have to look at this, and the whole point of a financial memorandum is best estimates, so we can look at the impact on the public purse. So where would you be for that? And I'll be asking the same question to your colleagues.
Aye, certainly. I mean, in terms of Dundee, obviously a compact city, some very challenging conditions to have a sort of like really efficient and cost-effective household waste recycling and collection system. So, and that's reflected in terms of where our recycling rate is. We've really worked hard to get it, and we still find it really difficult to get anywhere near where the target recycling rate is at the moment. So that's a major challenge for us, and that, to get that, it's a big investment, not just in infrastructure, which we've made over the years, but also in terms of communication, a lot more people on the ground to actually do that and engage. And again, I know we didn't ask that earlier, but we're over 50% of communal properties in Dundee, and some really challenging traditional housing types for the introduction of a comprehensive sort of a separated waste system. So we've got a lot there and a lot of investment going forward as well, but a lot of that will be not just in some of the capital things, but I think more people on the ground over and above that.
Savings, though, from this legislation, which is clear, so I'm just wondering what the net position is, because obviously it's hard for us to say local authorities want more money. I mean, you know, you really need to try and pin it down to some kind of ballpark figure, I would think, surely Dundee has considered how much additional funding, if it needs additional funding, it would require to deliver this bill and over what time period?
I mean, hard to put a number on it just now because we've had lots of different scenarios. So the main one is obviously if you don't pay to dispose of the waste, then that frees up that money to be invested elsewhere. But even moving recycling out to the market costs money. So it's not as easy to net it off as it would be against the cost of waste disposal versus the cost of recycling. So there's, and it changes quite a lot as well in terms of market values. So that can be a bit of a difficult one to cost up. But I think we do need a sort of a steady sort of a level of staff and level of engagement to be able to address the issues there. And whether that is there's enough money which will come from some of the changes to do that, to net that off within the council's revenue budgets for these staff requirements, I don't know at this particular moment.
So clearly, short of putting matches under your fingernails, I'm not going to get any cash figure from you, Mr. Devine.
To be honest with you, I think there's a lot. We need a lot more information than we're going forward. I think the financial memorandum is really helpful because it's given us much more scope for where to think. But I just don't think it's the finished article at the moment that we can give to Parliament to consider.
It's really ballpark stuff I'm looking for. Ms. Maguire, if you get anything.
I agree with Charlie. I think there's just too much uncertainty. There's not enough detail behind things at the moment. I can see that there will be savings in terms of litter clearance and litter disposal. But everybody else, there has to be investment. If we are looking at improving our recycling rate, and South Lanarkshire's recycling rate last year was 40.3, so we are not even... You know, an average, it's 43.3, so we're 3% below average. So even getting to that, we're going to need to invest, and we're going to need to invest in communal bin infrastructure, which just we are looking at putting in a bid to the small grant fund for RIF. And we're going to be looking at, we're looking at a pilot where we have our communal bins that have see-through panels, so to try and encourage our residents to maybe take a wee bit more ownership for the waste that goes in the bin. But these things need capital investment for those things.
Yeah. Mr. Jack, you're my last hope.
Sorry, Chair, to disappoint, but like my colleagues, when we considered this at committee, we really struggled to be able to articulate what you want to elected members as well because of the uncertainty that's there. And I've said earlier, I mean, some of the changes we've made have involved, you know, moving to a 7-day collection, which is a significant change for the council, and that was to save a sum in the region of about 340,000 just based on vehicle reductions. So we've had to make some big decisions in waste services of what it looks like for our community. My concern around it is I would like to give you a figure, but we're struggling to do so. As I say, the RIF fund has helped us with some of the infrastructure, but if that model changes a bit, then that money's been used and we will need to reapply for something else, which is an additional cost again.
I'm going to open up the session to colleagues around the table, and the first to ask a question will be Deputy Convener Michael, before by John.
Thanks, Convener. I'm conscious that this isn't the waste management process in your various councils is something that has changed probably quite dramatically over the last decade. So you've been through a lot of change processes in the period up to now. I think you've described some of them in part in terms of the changes that you've made. I mean, does, in kind of layman's terms, we're not going to get a figure maybe, but does this feel realistic in terms of the costs that are being set out here? Does it feel like a real, given your experience of change management and the costs of doing that, making those changes, does it feel realistic to you? Kirsty?
I think the big thing for me is we spoke about a figure for communications of £2.95, I think it was, per household. I think you also need back office staff for communications. So you have to have someone who develops that communication. So there is a resource in there, and you have to have people who deliver that communication, and you have to have accompanying programmes, education programmes that go with that. So I think there's quite a bit that is missing for me from the cost that we're looking at. And we know this as local authorities from experience, that you can't just issue about communication because people just put it in the bin. So you also have to have the staff behind that and the engagement behind that.
The financial memorandum sets out that there will be costs of £227,000 across 3 years for a local authority. I mean, that seems to me to be a vanishingly small. The first answer we had today was from Mr. Devine, who said that he was looking at a £1.5 to £2 million capital investment and 5 to 10 additional staff to set up one waste management centre to deal with this. But the allocation is £227,000 across 3 years. Is that realistic?
No.
No. Kirsty, Jim, is that realistic?
I think from our own experience with the change management stuff we are in at the moment, as colleagues have said, the education engagement part of that would be, in my view, would be higher. We'd need more. And it's not something that you can do in a fortnight and then not need to revisit again. You know, recycling rates dip. I think we all sign up to the message. We all think we're doing better than we actually are. But if you look at the national figures, I mean, there is so much recyclable material in the grey bins, despite all the campaigns of late. You know, it's very difficult to shift that.
OK. So the Section 48 of the memorandum states that Zero Waste Scotland have calculated the cost of implementing the current code of practice at £88.4 million. Do you know where that figure has come from, Mr. Devine?
I can make an educated guess, having been a former employee there. So I'll be through a lot of, a lot of assumptions, a lot of research, some comparators with other nations as well. And I know we tend to mention Wales a lot because Wales are obviously the higher performing, but the Welsh model, as we quote, has been a completely different investment cycle and a different collection system, so it's not quite comparable in terms of previous investment that's there to get it. I think the other assumption there from the costs is that we assumed that we had a fully functioning back office at the moment, so this was really just topping up what we needed to implement the bill. But from what my colleagues have said is, you know, that isn't there in terms of its entirety, so it's not just starting from a level playing field, but it's having to go back the way and reinvest again to get back to where we should be before we move on to where the bill is, the level engagement.
So you're making some of these well-educated assumptions in terms of where some of this may have come from, but it's not been set out to colleagues as to where that figure has come from. Detail on it. Heads.
There was a lot of papers obviously went with it and a lot of research that Zero Waste Scotland had done. So again, a lot of that could be desktop based as well, and obviously looking across Europe where things can be quite different from where they are, considering things like pay-as-you-throw, for instance, distorts things. So there's not that sort of direct variable charging isn't there. We're kind of working from obviously whatever was collected via the council tax bands. So there's lots of challenges there, and it doesn't make it fully comparable with where we're trying to go from
and
at the moment.
Are colleagues aware of any discussions between your local authorities and Zero Waste Scotland or the Scottish Government about that figure, about where it's come from? Have you had that in detail set out?
No.
Okay. So also in Section 48, it sets out the detail, or some detail, around the extended producer responsibility. And the convener touched on this already, saying that that's going to be one of the areas where there will be an income stream to try and offset some costs. Are you aware of any discussions as to the scale of that, how much money might come in, and how that would be distributed across the different local authorities?
I can probably speak for my own authority on that point. So obviously we take part in the DEFRA organised research for that. So there's quite a lot of work going on in the background in terms of trying to work out what that figure should be for each material stream and each local authority. But ultimately, when that money is there, it will go to the Scottish Government. And unless it's ring-fenced, for instance, then obviously it could become an additional fund that can be invested into any part of the service. So there's some issues there, even though if it may generate additional money for us, that whether that money becomes, as I say, a ring-fence fund that the local authorities can benefit from directly for waste management, or it becomes a treasury transaction, that the money just becomes part of the overall cost system. And I can understand why that would happen either way.
So, but no clarity so far, because I suppose you're shaking your head, Kirsty, as well. You don't know whether we've got anything in terms of whether it's going to go into the block grant, or whether it might be a fund to be bidded into.
Or whether it will replace an element of the block grant. So it's not even been confirmed yet whether the local authorities will receive that additional money. So, and that is obviously a major concern, because there is an assumption that we will receive the money from the EPR. we may not.
Okay, that's very useful. Mm. And my question, next question, I suppose, is about the distributional effect of some of that. I mean, given what's just been said, we don't have real clarity or understanding of it. But there are, as a Dundonian, have sympathy with Mr. Devine's position regarding the challenge of collecting waste in a local authority with the tightest boundaries in the UK, 50% of which is flatted. Is there any indication of or discussion with government about a recognition of those challenges?
I suppose we've made them that many times for different things, but I think it's there within, if you look at the performance rates and how difficult, how much money we're investing in not to have a high performance system, then I think that should be recognition on its own. But I think we do raise those points quite a lot, and any submissions that we put in, as you will see, we try and sort of highlight those as challenges for us to deliver these things. And I don't think that the ambition's to be as good as we possibly can. Yeah. You know? So it's not lack of effort. I think it's probably just circumstances, and then try to sort of find a way around those circumstances.
Yeah. So I recognise that, but there's no direct recognition within the discussions around this bill or otherwise in terms of why those rates are so low. I suppose part of it is the answers to the convener around the fines that might be levied on local authorities for not making a recycling rate over the long term, and if this is actually increases the challenges of that, if we want to see Dundee City Council fined for not being able to make a recycling rate, which is actually a factor of the boundaries that it has set for them by the Scottish Government, not actually about any performance by individuals or the group that you work in, Mr. Devine. I mean, is that something that the Council has expressed? Is there any recognition of that in how the financial aspects of this might be dealt with?
Yes, I suppose in discussions I've been in, group discussions with Scottish Government colleagues within that particular team, so there is a recognition that in terms of demographics and in terms of achievability might not be there in terms of a flat recycling rate for all local authorities. So some local authorities may be better placed to achieve higher rates and some lower, depending on those particular circumstances. So there is a recognition for that. I haven't seen any models or any sort of other documentation that would back that up, other than sort of positive comments from Scottish Government colleagues that it's something they will have to consider. And that may be part of sort of secondary legislation as it comes through.
I think that would be very important. Mr. Jack, you mentioned in one of your previous answers about the, I suppose you alluded to it, some of the challenges around, I think you were walking into some area of deprivation, potentially, about reclaiming fines. Is there any recognition, as you see, for a local authority about how deprivation and the challenges of reclaiming fines and changing behaviour in those areas, that might be recognised in any of the financial structures?
I think the only certainty I could comment on that, Chair, would be round about littering fines, and we have a lot of difficulty in the local authority getting them pursued in these kind of areas, and they become a cost to us if we can actually get to a point where we can try to recover the money. So that did raise a concern that the income side of it seems to be predicated on almost 100% payment of fines. I'm not aware of that being achieved in terms of littering, certainly not within my own authority. And you know, factors like deprivation or the choice of where you pay the fine or you pay your rent has been said to me in the past when we've been pursuing that.
Okay. A final question, if that's okay, Camilla. You mentioned, Kirsty, the savings that you thought might be realisable around littering and litter reclamation. I mean, I know that street cleaning in Dundee has been cut to the bone. You know, there's been several rounds of cutbacks due to the cuts to local government, £6 billion taken out over the last decade across Scotland. I mean, is it realistic to think that we can actually scale back those services any further? I mean, there will always be some level of residual waste, even if we take coffee cups out of it. I mean, it doesn't feel to me like we have a service that's actually up to scratch as it is at the moment in lots of parts of Scotland, let alone the idea that we might then be able to scale it back further. Are those the kind of jobs and savings that you're identifying?
Not through this, no. This is solely on disposal costs. So okay. From street cleansing. So we are under pressure to make significant savings through street cleansing and through our ground services. And, you know, it is likely that there will be a reduction in service provision as a consequence of that, if these savings are taken. So we will have less bodies on the ground for street cleansing services. So I don't see any savings as a consequence of this bill in terms of employees or vehicles, but I do recognise if there's less weight in the bins, then there's less disposal costs.
Okay. Thank you. That's clear.
Thank you. Just one point. Dundee's boundaries were set pre-devolution. John, to be followed by Liz.
Thanks very much, convener. Following on some of the points that have been made already, you said, I think, Mr. Devine, that if the financial memorandum was helpful and it goes into a bit more detail than you had before. But is there enough detail in it, or are you accepting that there has to be uncertainty because of the further discussions that have to take place, or should there be more certainty within the financial memorandum?
I think there needs to be more certainty from that, but I have to recognise that there are changes in transit at the moment, and some we don't have any control over in terms of being set from Westminster, for instance, in terms of the EPR. So there's that level of uncertainty, and there always has been. But I think the thing is, there's no really any headroom to do anything with it if something changes there. Or the other thing is, we'll have to enter into long-term contracts, and that's really difficult if halfway through the contract something changes. And obviously, waste disposal was probably the most prominent one, but even for the offtakes or recycling, we're entering into short-term contracts where we don't benefit, because DRS was a good example. We couldn't go beyond August this year with that material stream, and then all of a sudden we have to go back to the market again with another short term. So it can be quite challenging from that point of view, and it's hard for the financial memorandum to account for that. But we know that you can go out and get a much lower income from material and a much higher cost for processing, all within just a very short period of time. So it's very, very difficult, I suppose, a bit of a live situation. And that's difficult to get into that level of detail within a document like that. But I think there needs to be recognition that market rates will change, and depending on how certain things are for us.
So, Mr. Jack or Ms. Maguire, we as a committee have to go back and say, this is a good financial memorandum or it's a bad financial memorandum. So which do you think we should say?
I think it's just, we would just like a wee bit more detail about how the assumptions have been made, where did they come from, I suppose. Mm-hmm. Neutral.
Yeah, I think, Chairperson, it's sitting on the fence, and I think from our point of view, we'd difficulty just understanding it and be able to articulate back to elected members and others as to whether we would be no worse off. And that's been the concern that we had, and I totally get Mr. Devine's point about there has to be some indication given, there has to be some means of measuring what the cost of this and what the benefits would be. But I think the uncertainty in the market, and I did mention earlier, we're about to go to tender to one of our biggest contracts, and we're expecting there will be a significant price increase in that, which is partly due this, I think, to uncertainty.
Okay, thanks. Again, some of these points have come from the Dundee paper, so that's why I'm focusing on that. But you make the point that on disposal of unsold goods, there is no budget at all put in for councils. Should there be?
I think, yes, but there should be recognition of that. I suppose the point when I put it in there is we probably don't deal in that retail-type environment. So, again, but it would be where that material gets passed on to you for disposal, for instance. So if that's through a household disposal system, then we would pick up the cost for that. And one of that might be giving stuff away at the retail level to a householder who then doesn't need it or want it, and then it finds its way back into the waste system. And that's quite common at the moment in terms of buy one, get one free type things in food, for instance, where when there is a campaign for that, you can see the food waste horizons going up significantly because it's free, you might not take it, but when it's not wanted or required, then it goes through. So I think that would need to be considered how that works.
It's a slightly different angle, but on that same subject in the financial memorandum, the costs that SEPA might get or need on this same subject of disposal of unsold consumer goods are ranging from, it says, 30,000 to 200,000, 200,000 being if they were more proactive. And I find that interesting because that's a very wide range. And it brings in the issue about being proactive. I didn't particularly see that elsewhere, either for councils or for anyone else. But it kind of raises the wider question of, I mean, do you want to be more proactive? Do you need to be more proactive? And would that really cost like seven times doing the minimum?
it's funny. I think it's where that's obviously, in my personal view, that it looks as if it's targeted towards the retail and wholesale type market rather than household waste. And I do recognise that household waste would be affected by that at some particular point, as the examples I'd given. But
so I'm even thinking wider than just the unsold consumer goods. That, you know, going through all of this. Do you think the costs and the finances and the expectation is that you will do the minimum, or do you think there's an expectation, or do you hope to be more proactive in this whole area?
I think we need to be more proactive to be realistic, because in terms of reuse, for instance, then that's a major element of what we're trying to do, rather not just about managing waste, so but reuse is part of that as well in terms of unsold goods and whether they find its way back to a useful life within either household or wider markets for that. Probably the example at the moment is probably food waste because of the perishability aspect of it. So elsewhere, legislation is pushing for wholesalers and retailers to put that food material back into use again rather than disposal route. For various reasons, but in terms of other household goods, I think that would be quite challenging because it could be anything, really.
Yeah. I mean, Mr. Jack, I think it was you that said that there was quite a lot of waste going into residual waste, and I think there was a figure somewhere that said 60% of residual waste could have been recycled. And, I mean, it seems to me where I live in Glasgow, or my part of Glasgow at least, you know, some of it's a lack of education, so people put lots of things in a plastic bag and put the plastic bag in the recycling, whereas, as I understand it, the plastic bag shouldn't go in the recycling, the paper and the cans should just all be put in loose. So there's a bit of an education thing. There's also a bit of confusion between different councils, because some of us who live close to other councils, my mother used to live in South Lanarkshire, they did things differently from the way Glasgow does them. It used to be the case here in Parliament for Edinburgh that I had to put both the plastic bottle and the top into the recycling bin, whereas in Glasgow you don't put the top in, you only put the bottle in. So, you know, there is quite a lot of confusion here, for one thing, which would presumably mean we need education. But on the other hand, I mean, some people, there's a kind of macho image, at least in Glasgow, that, you know, you don't put litter in the bin. That's kind of, you know, it doesn't give you the right image, it's not cool. And then you certainly don't split your rubbish up between different bins, because that's not cool either. So, can the councils do more? Should the councils be doing more? And will that cost more if you were to start challenging some of these things?
Yeah, I think, Chair, in terms of being proactive around that message, I think local authorities generally are. I mean, certainly within my own council, the waste disposal budgets and within my remit as head of service, which includes a number of frontline services in West Lothian, I mean, it's a concern to me that we have to pay to get rid of waste. You want to reduce that cost as much as you could, so that the work I mentioned earlier about where we were in our journey, West Lothian was recycling pretty well. There was changes made to the reporting frameworks which show our recycling rates has been lower, principally because we're using more energy from waste in terms of the contracts that go through. So we are proactive in what we're doing, and as I said earlier, we've benefited from the RIF fund to help with that. The issue round about the market certainty and the customer use, I suppose, as simple as you can make it, would be best for the customer. But to get clean products back to the market, then we have to split our waste into different streams. And there is difference across councils. I think Charlie commented on that earlier as well. So I don't think there's a standard fit. The messaging needs to be topped up regularly, and I think that's a journey that we're on again at the moment. And these trials that I mentioned earlier, much as they're intense for these two communities we're in, I don't think the journey finishes at the end date of the trial. We'll need to keep going back.
To go as far as being, because I think, perhaps myself and some of my neighbours, what we need is somebody to come round from the council and say, look at that bin, that should be in it, that shouldn't be in it. You know, and I've, in all the time we've had recycling in Glasgow, I've never seen that happen or have a leaflet through my door or anything. It's just every week the wrong stuff goes into the wrong bin and it just carries on.
Yeah, Chair, if I could maybe answer that. In terms of West Lothian, then that wouldn't be your experience with us. We are using a tagging system. The education staff at the moment are out in front of the refuse collection wagons. They are looking at the content of the bin as best they can. They're door knocking where they can. There is letters that we're dropping to help encourage people to recycle. That message is labour intensive to get through and can be contentious. You know, we're seeing an increase in adverse customer reaction, albeit in the minority, to our staff who are only doing their job to help everybody recycle for a message which the majority of people get and you know, might not be fully complying with.
And yeah, I mean, some people are fanatical. Hopefully my sister's not watching, but I mean, she takes the labels off the jam jars and everything. I mean, just what I would consider ridiculous. But anyway, Ms. McGuire, following on that?
Yeah, no, it's a similar situation in South Lanarkshire. So I had touched on earlier on that we had introduced a tagging campaign, and that was because our material and our recycling bins had, we'd changed contractor and we realised that what we thought was good quality wasn't in fact good quality. So we continue to do that. So if our crews identify that there is the wrong items within the bin, we will tag it and we won't lift it. And our refuse collection crews will include that information in our in-cab system so that that goes to our contact centre. And then if someone in the contact centre gets a call from a resident to say that their bin has been missed, which is quite common, not that their bin is missed, just that they report that the bin is missed because we haven't lifted it, because they've contaminated it. And then right away the resident can say that the contact centre can say that it's because there was the wrong items in the bin, and we can arrange a follow-up visit from a resident.
I mean, that sounds positive. Mr. Devine, in the cities, is that just not possible, that level of involvement?
But really difficult in terms of communal, because it's difficult to identify if it's a single offender within a block of six flats or everybody's the same, so or if somebody's just walking past in the street and doing something. And there's what we call wish cycling as well, so people are not quite sure, so they put it in a recycling bin and we deal with that. That's one thing, but it's just deliberately contaminating the material. It's the most difficult for us for that, and it's lots of time and effort. And again, probably Dundee as an example has got quite a big transient population in terms of the people coming into the city for to study at university, so they get a short burst of new people coming in and then having to educate them and work with the various sort of landlords and housing associations to do it. So it's quite challenging for that. As I say, we've got a system which has been pretty stable for the last 7 or 8 years as part of a previous investment, and it offers those within the communal properties and those within sort of a back and front door. We run exactly the same system, so really just to try and avoid that confusion element for it. But again, it still becomes challenging. And probably the contamination element, the vast majority of that is within the communal system at the moment. So we know where the challenges are for that.
Okay. On another subject or angle, I picked up the point, I think, again, that you'd made that you might not be allowed to charge for uplift of specific items like garden waste in future. Now, Glasgow's just started doing that, and I think other councils have been doing that.
Yep.
Can you explain to us what the issue is there?
It was some work that's been done. I think it was through Zero Waste Scotland, but it was really that one of the barriers to recycling was that if you charged for something, so obviously local authorities charge for garden waste at the moment because it's not a prescribed item, so they can't charge for it. It's similar for bulky items. So the issue for that particularly within some councils, were on the same, that's been the case for a number of years, so now that's now an established revenue stream. There is recognition that obviously some material could slip into the residual waste stream, so there's other ways of dealing with that in terms of different frequencies for residual bins, etc. But again, that at the moment gives us the opportunity to, one, cover the cost of that opt-in service, but also to be able to continue to support the other services within the scheme as well. So quite challenging if that was to be taken away, which it was. And the example that I looked at wasn't just that study, but also what had been taking place in terms of the wider UK, waste research that was there. So we wanted to include that, really just to flag it up to the committee that it could be a potential issue for that. But I do realise in terms of that position has changed down south as well, as far as I know, that they're not no longer going to give councils the option if they want to charge for that. The other thing, I suppose, is we actually process our own garden waste, so we produce a product that we can use and market as well. So it's trying to protect that, I suppose, self-sufficiency we have in dealing with those materials.
And Ms McGuire and Mr Jack, are you just kind of the same, or do you want to add anything on that issue?
Not really anything the same. I think we're just the uncertainty over whether that will come in or not. I mean, as you just alluded to, Glasgow have just recently introduced a charge for garden waste uplifts. If we knew that was 100% happening, then I suspect that wouldn't have happened. But it's another area of waste that is uncertain in, which makes it pretty difficult to make anything medium or longer term decisions.
Okay.
Yeah, I mean, Chair, we don't charge for garden waste at the moment, but we have food waste and garden waste combined, and we're not alone in that, as a local authority, and some others do charge in relation to that combined service. So our council has looked at it, and it's not to say that we'll not need to look at it again.
Okay. I mean, just to pick up another point you made, Mr Jack, I think you referred to grey bins. Now, I don't know what you put in grey bins in your council. In our area, grey bins are just for food. I think that's probably not the case. Could the councils not work together and get the same colour of bins? Would that help?
I've been speaking about this for 20 years, I think.
Yeah. I think that there was some work done on that as part of some previous legislation that was out. I'm not sure if it were, whether it was the Waste Scotland regulations 2012 for that harmonisation part of that, and it was a considerable cost. It was in the hundreds of millions, so it kind of took it out. It would be good if somebody didn't have a service that they hadn't rolled out yet, and when they did invest, that they harmonised in terms of that bin colour. But I think it was quite open. It was quite a range of, and it is difficult because it means cross-boundary communications. For instance, if you stay quite close to two councils, as you mentioned yourself, you can get the wrong message, put the wrong stuff in the wrong bin, simply through something on the radio or something that pops through.
Okay, I'll accept that's a problem. And the final issue I wanted just to was the littering from vehicles. I mean, I just find it hard to get my head around it, how this can possibly work, because unless somebody's there with a camera, would it have to have a camera to photograph the person actually dropping the litter out of the vehicle? And what would the cost of that be? Because it does suggest, I think, in the financial memorandum that it could be self-financing. Is that possible?
I don't think it will be self-financing. No. And that's just from previous experience. I mean, the South Lanarkshire Council has, in the past, we have issued fines for people who have dropped litter from cars, and that's been based on reports that we've received, because we've taken that as being, we have a reason to believe, and if someone has provided evidence to suggest that they have seen litter dropping from a car, it's...
challenge that then, would you find it hard to prove?
And that's a difficulty, and that's where you get the difficulty in terms of recovery.
Yes.
Chair, if I could maybe just add, I mean, if you're fining someone for littering, then there's corroboration required. If you're caught speeding with a camera, there's no corroboration required. And that's a difficulty we have as local authorities. So the small team of environment wardens that we have will have cameras, but we have to put them out in pairs to be able to do the corroboration. So that impacts on the cost points that's been put forward in the memorandum as well. If you need corroboration, then if you're funded for two people, they're working together.
Yeah. OK, I'll leave it at that. Thanks so much, Convener.
Thank you very much, Liz.
Thank you. You've all been extremely helpful in telling us where you think the costs might have an underestimate and some of the difficulties that we have to look at from the financial memorandum perspective. Could I just ask you, are you clear, or do you think there's more clarity about where the responsibility for the costs will fall, namely between national government, between local government, between SEPA? Do you think there is sufficient clarity about who will be responsible for which costs, or do we need more clarity on that?
I didn't pick up there was any issues on that. I thought it was clear to me, but that's me just... you guys may have a different opinion.
I think that probably, because I don't come from a regulatory background, probably clarity would be good for me from a personal point of view, because it did look as if it was like everybody had a role in it, but nobody who was actually going to lead on that.
I'm just asking the question because I know at the Net Zero Committee, when they're looking at the bill, there were some questions about, you know, who was going to be liable for specific costs and whether we need to have a little bit more clarity within the financial memorandum, or whether it's just a numbers game.
Mm-hmm. Oh, definitely. I think that probably the way it works at the moment, for instance, where we know where the boundaries are between SEPA and local government, for instance, when it comes to an offence having taken place, yeah. Whatever, but when it comes to some of the multi-agency approach type things that you might need, I'm not quite sure who would be the lead on that, unless it was designated, and obviously that would then become the financial issue with them.
Okay, that may be something that we can pursue. Just going back to this issue about behavioural change, which I think is absolutely critical to the whole debate, do you feel that when it comes to recycling centres, that we need to do more to try to encourage use of these recycling centres, and that they will be open at the times that they say that they'll be open? And I mean, certainly in my own local authority, there have been issues about staffing for that. There are two or three local centres that are going to be closed for certain times during the week, and the hours are going to be cut. Do we need to do more to encourage people to use these recycling centres?
Pretty well used in South Lanarkshire. And I know that because I do tend to get complaints about queues. So I think what there is people try to use them all at the same time. And so you have times throughout the day where they're not well used. And you can understand that because people are at work or college or university or whatever. And then everyone goes at the same time. But from South Lanarkshire point of view, it doesn't seem to be an issue for us. We're open from 8 in the morning till 7 at night, all our sites, during summer hours, and from 8 till 4:30, I think, or 8 till 5 o'clock during winter hours. So we have quite long, generous operating hours.
Yeah. So is there an increase in the number of people who are using these centres?
So everyone experienced through the pandemic, there was a massive increase, and it caused us all serious issues. We've just returned back to kind of normal usage now, so I think it's pretty steady.
Yeah, because presumably there's
From South Lanarkshire point of view.
Right. Presumably there's some scope for cost reduction if there is greater use of these recycling centres.
No, you just get your costs just move to somewhere else, and actually it's probably for us, it's probably more expensive to take waste through our recycling centres than it is through our curbside.
Right, well, it comes back to the question about responsibility for costs, because, I agree with all the previous speakers have asked about behavioural change, because I think it is so critical to solving a lot of this issue, and I think we've got a big job to do to get people to understand quite a lot of the implications of not taking responsible attitudes when it comes to waste management. And I think I agree with the point that there is a lot of confusion out there, as in I can speak from a Perth and Kinross angle where, you know, two new excellent bins have appeared for cans, plastics and tins, but that actually covers exactly two other existing bins which took the same thing, plus cardboard and paper. But we've got other bins for these as well, but all of these bins now exist and nobody's quite sure where to put anything. So I think, I cite that as an example where I think it would be very helpful for local authorities to be extremely clear as to what goes where, because that must have an implication on costs.
And I think we're all agreed on that. Communication is the key to this. Mm. Just quickly before we leave the CA site or the HWRC topic, I think there's a role for civic community sites in bringing materials that we don't accept to the curbside. So I think that's really important for recycling. So batteries, for example, electrical goods, or larger white goods. We're having, obviously, across the country, issue with lithium-ion batteries. So having somewhere to take that, or gas bottles, because gas bottles ending up in the back of RCVs causes major issues at Wharfs and our energy from waste facilities. So there's definitely a role there.
When it comes to public information, education about this issue, what have you found to be the most successful channel of ensuring that people adhere? Is it leaflets around the doors, or is it people telling them that the bin's been contaminated, they've got to sort it out? What's been the most effective way of communicating?
For us, recently, we've invested more in door-knocking exercises. Right. We have problems in flatted areas where residents will just put out rubbish and just expect it to be removed, so they won't phone for a bulk uplift, despite the fact that South Lanarkshire still provides one free to each household every year. And so we've had to basically, and it's really labour intensive, but we've found that there's been a benefit. We've sent our waste education team out and they've knocked doors and they've delivered leaflets and they've given one-on-one advice, and it has made a difference, but it is costly and it is not feasible for us to do it across the wider area, because the area is far too big.
And is it possible to distinguish between the more rural areas where you can't possibly be expected to go door knocking, just too difficult to do that, and the urban areas? Have we got a better public information campaign in the urban areas than we have in a rural area?
No, I wouldn't say so, because with a lot of the communication it will be South Lanarkshire wide, so through social media platforms or on a website. We have a publication called The View that has stories in there, but the door knocking we will concentrate on the areas where we have a real problem, and often or not, these tend to be in our more built up areas.
Okay, that's very helpful.
Thank you, Michelle.
Good morning. Thank you for giving all the information you have done so far. And of course, what this session has brought out is a considerable both uncertainty and complexity, and what we're doing with that. I mean, as the convener earlier pointed out, the point of an FM, but also adding on to that, an FM should show the margins of uncertainty for any estimate. And I mean, I often kind of, you know, search in keywords on things just to kind of get a picture of it. And there isn't really any particular disclaimer of uncertainty, but there is quite a lot of, if you search in the word range and then you look at the ranges, and the ranges are vast in the estimates. You know, some of the figures, like for regulation, from £30,000 to £200,000, and you're going to, basically, the bigger the range, the higher the uncertainty and the less accurate the estimate. But I just wanted to get your sense of that from a confidence point of view. Are there any particular areas, because I accept there's a lot of information come out this morning, where you think that the range of estimate expressing uncertainty is so utterly huge as to be kind of really not worth very much at all, in addition to what you've already said this morning? Charlie, you smiled at me, so you could go first.
I was just thinking there, is, I suppose we kind of work in that world, and we start off with a really broad range, and as you get more information, you start to narrow that range down to something that you can live with, you know, and that tends to be where we are. But the range is vast, as you say, and I think, I mean, obviously, from all local authorities, everybody's in a slightly different place, so everybody will have a different idea of it. I think, as we mentioned, probably where we are is that we need to invest money in certain parts of the service in terms of communications, for instance, and how we do that, and where are the balance of having more communications and less enforcement. And I always see personally, if you have to enforce something and everything else has failed, so it's always been a big challenge for that. So it's to try and, do you have 10 people out there pushing the message and one person dealing with the thing, and that sort of gives you the idea of where the range would come into it for that. But it's quite challenging to do that and to really have more information. And the only way you've got more information is to be quite far down the line where we are, probably beyond financial memorandum.
I'm going to come on to that. To either Kirsty or Jim, we want to bring out where you think one or a number of ranges are so vast by quantum that you think, well, actually, they're almost like worse than useless. But you've put a lot of information on the table today, but I suppose I'm trying to establish where the ranges are so vast that you think, well, this now becomes largely meaningless.
Mr. Chair, the bit for me would be round about where the interventions work best. And I think that's the bit where I'm, from a local authority point of view, a bit uncertain. I mean, the chain or the circular economy, get the point that if everybody plays a part, you must have something better at the end. But if we're introducing the local authority bit in the middle of the chain and there's not the upstream or downstream changes, then that makes it hard for us. And that's certainly a bit that I struggle with, just reading through to see what it means specifically for our council. I appreciate that's not answered your question fully. It's maybe introducing something new into the mix, but there is a bit about the sequencing of the changes.
Okay. I mean, I think I've probably made my point about the vast ranges, and both Charlie and Jack, you've alluded to the behavioural changes, and that's the uncertainty element in terms of this bill. I want to pick up on something that my colleague John earlier asked, where he used the terminology good and bad, but I'm going to make it a little more academic and say, on a scale of 0 to 10, where 0 is no confidence in the estimates and 10 is high confidence in the estimates. And I think we can fairly reflect that you express considerable uncertainty in also what it means for you. So this isn't meant to be apportioning blame. I'm just trying to reflect where we are in process. So what number would each of you give to this aim, this FM, where 0 is nul point, literally, and 10 is a high degree of confidence?
I'm going to go under 5. Okay.
So is that a 4 and then, just to be specific?
And it's just on, and I understand why. I think it's pretty difficult to attribute costs when you've not got the full picture. Mm. So there's not, we don't know what the secondary legislation is going to look like. We don't know what the other thing, you know, the other legislation, if what form it's going to take. We don't know what the form that the EPR stuff's going to take. So it does make it really pretty difficult, to be fair to the people who have written a financial memorandum, to put any meaningful figures in here.
Okay. And Charlie and Jim? A number.
I'm trying to avoid sitting on the fence here.
Yeah, exactly. That's why I'm asking a number.
I think I'm in the same area as Kirsty, to be honest. 4. I mean, okay. It would be tempting to say 5, but that doesn't achieve what you want.
I'm not looking for anything. I'm just trying to get a measure on the table. So you can choose between 4 and 5. This is not a trick question.
Slightly more optimistic. I think there's a lot of work went into it. I think there's more work to go there, but I think that it's there and it's on the right track. I just think then a bit more work in the background and a bit more understanding of what the other costs are rather than the ones they're just trying to address, because I don't think it's, you couldn't narrow it down to a single function that you want to identify, because it's part of a chain of events that happens within local authorities to get to that stage. Mm-hmm. So I think probably a bit more understanding about what the chain of events are and what the actual cost is for that would be helpful.
And you've led me on to my kind of final question. In terms of in an ideal world, where we go from here that recognises all the evidence you've given this morning, in terms of co-design, which was brought up earlier by the convener, what ideally would you like to see happen to get to something that ups these scores, where we can all have more confidence in the FM and fully accepting the uncertainty and complexity and all the differential points you've made about councils? Is it fundamentally about a continued exercise of co-design and the production of an updated FM, or are you happy for this extra work to slip under secondary legislation? You know, if you had a choice, what would you choose and why?
It's a difficult one. I think to address the co-design at this particular level, I think it would be really difficult and it would probably lengthen the process considerably. But I think what we need to make sure, if it did become part of secondary legislation and the work was done there, that it was recognised at this level that it could bring other changes, you know, that may have to go back. And the co-design thing, it's as big and complicated as you want to make it for that. And I think what's happened, and you'll probably see from other examples in the UK, is they've spent a lot of time and effort and have had to go back to basics again. So I think it's to recognise that as It's involving all the partners and making sure that we're played by proper partners in the circular economy, but also to make sure that it is viable and workable on the ground. And obviously the citizens can actually contribute to that system rather than just being brought in at the last minute and no understanding it. So I think, and probably the example we spoke about communication there, but probably we should test the public to see what their understanding of the circular economy is at the moment, you know, considering that it can take quite a lot of people that time just to figure it out themselves at our level. So
it's the same question to Kirsty and Jim. What do you think should happen now to move us on from where we are in terms of co-design or secondary legislation?
And this isn't whether we rework the financial memorandum at this stage or whether we wait until there's secondary
legislation. I mean, that is an option.
I think if we get to the stage where there's secondary legislation, then we at least know the direction that we're travelling in. I think the uncertainty just now makes it really difficult, as I'd said previously. And it may be that once we know more about what's happening in the waste sector, we'll be able to come up with some better assumptions and some more relevant costings.
Yeah, final comment, Jim.
Yeah, I think I'm of the same mind, and the secondary legislation is the area that maybe creates us the biggest concern at the moment, because we don't know what it looks like. I totally appreciate the point that Mr. Devine made as well about needing to progress and needing to have some parameters to work to. And I suppose the concern for all of us would be that one part isn't locked down in isolation of the other. You know, which is back to your point about the scale between the two figures is quite large. Yeah, so I think I'd be minded to go that way.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you very much. That's concluded the questions from the committee. I think a circular economy is one of these phrases that just appeared, and I don't think the public really know a lot about it. It's like when Tony Blair came in 1997 and social exclusion suddenly became the phrase that everybody used. So I think there's some education in terms of circular economy. I'm just going to say one thing. Even the financial memorandum itself points out that it's not got all the answers. So, for example, it says in section 33, it's not possible at this stage to provide definitive estimates about the extent of any additional costs or benefits to local authorities that have associated with the introduction of enforcement tools for local authorities in relation to householders' recycling obligations. So the financial memorandum itself admits that it's not actually the full answer there. So I want to thank all three of you for giving your evidence today. It's really greatly appreciated, and we'll take evidence on the Circular Economy Bill from the Scottish Government at our next meeting on the 7th of November. So with that in mind, I'm just wondering if there's any final points that any of our witnesses would like to prefer, something we might not have touched on that you feel we should have, or any specific points that you want to make sure we don't omit when the Minister comes before us in a couple of weeks.
Anything else?
No,
covered everything.
Okay, well, thank you very much. So that concludes the public work for today of the committee. We now move into private session to consider our work programme, and I'll just call a wee break till 10:55 to enable our witnesses and the official report to leave. Thank you.